Well, hey, I want to welcome you to our Bible study here on Tuesday night, September the 1st, and we thank you for joining us. For those who are able, of course, we do have a Bible study at 7 o'clock. You get to see me live out on the front lawn. We get to sing some music if you would like to join us. Of course, our YouTube channel, we always present the premiere of the online version of this Bible study at 7:30 p.m. So we're thankful that you get to join us here today, but please be aware we do have in-person worship services every Sunday at 10 a.m. and in-person Bible study every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. So you're certainly welcome to join us. However, we're still wearing masks. We want to protect and be respectful for those who are around us. But let's take a look at our lesson for today. Before we begin, let's begin with prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this opportunity to learn more about you from the Holy Scriptures, from the book of Exodus. And we know that you want to continue to speak to us still, for we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we look at our lesson for today, as I said, we're doing these continuous lessons that we run into on Sunday mornings right now from the book of Exodus. Last week we learned a little bit about Moses being born as a baby and how he was given over by his mother to Pharaoh's daughter, the princess. And so this is kind of what we've missed between last week's lesson and today's lesson, because it can be a little bit confusing. We're not reading it in its entirety. We're depending upon you to fill in the gaps between this week and the next week's lesson and last week's lesson today. So what did we miss? Again, Moses, he was a Jew, but he was raised by an Egyptian princess, the daughter of Pharaoh, and he grew up to be a young man. He was a little bit frustrated. Remember, he's living in both worlds. Foot in both worlds. He's a Jew, but he's also Egyptian. He was frustrated by the cruel treatment that was being imposed upon upon the Jews by Pharaoh. Again, we still don't know who this Pharaoh is. Pharaoh is unnamed at this point. Now, in the process, he saw this cruel treatment of his brothers and sisters, other Jews, at the hands of a very harsh taskmaster. And we are told in one of the stories in the Bible how Moses killed by accident this taskmaster. And because he was afraid, he thought that now he might be designated as a terrorist or as a violent man or as a zealot who is out to get Pharaoh. Even though he is related by choice, by adoption to the Pharaoh, he decided that his best plan of attack at this point was to leave, to escape Egypt, and there he went out into the wilderness. And he married a woman, a Midianite woman, to a priest called Jethro, and we're told that he spent another 40 years in the desert. Now, these numbers are important because I do not necessarily believe that they are meant to be taken literally. They are meant to be taken as an indication of a long time. 40 is an indication of a long time of preparation. So we run into this number over and over. It could have been 20 years, could have been 10 years, could have been 50 years. Who knows? That's not the point. We are not meant to take these numbers literally. They're meant, just as we run into Jesus 40 days of in the wilderness of temptation, of fasting before the temptation. It's a time of preparation. So anytime you run into the number 40, think again in terms of long time of preparation for what is to come next. So Moses spent 40 years as a prince in Egypt, a long term of preparation. He spent 40 years in the wilderness, a long time of preparation for what was to come next. Now, as I mentioned, he married a Midianite woman, and he became a shepherd. And Egypt, by this point, is in his rearview mirror. And that's where we get into our lesson for today. So, Exodus chapter 3 is what we're reading. Moses was pasturing the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of God appeared to him in a blazing fire from the midst. Now, isn't it interesting? I want you to notice this. First of all, it's an angel. And then it all of a sudden transforms into God. This is oftentimes what happens. At first, it seems like it's just a messenger of God. But let's go on. And Moses looked in the bush, and it was burning with fire, yet the bush was not consumed. So Moses said, I must turn aside and see this marvelous sight. Hey, who wouldn't? How spectacular is this? Why is the bush not being burned up? So when the Lord saw that he had turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. He said, Do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for this place on which you're standing is holy ground. He also said, I'm the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. So Moses then hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Again, there was this belief that if you look at God, you would die. But we see many times in the Bible how that's just simply not true. There are many people who actually do look upon the face of God because God is not quite as terrifying as we are led to believe. God is a God who wants to have relationship with us. But at this point, they still have this myth about God. If they see the face of God, they would die. Now, the Lord said, I surely have seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt. I've given heed to their cry because of their taskmasters, for I'm aware of their sufferings. I have come down to deliver them from the power of the Egyptians, to bring them from the land to the good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. They're all Canaanites, by the way, just different branches of the Canaanites, just like the Jews. As we've mentioned in the past, Jews were also Canaanites. Ethnically and also by blood, they are also Canaanites. Now, behold, the cry of the sons of Israel has come to me. Furthermore, I've seen the oppression to which the Egyptians are oppressing them. So, Moses sees this burning bush that is not consumed by fire. It piqued his curiosity. He thinks it's an angel, a messenger of God, and God speaks to him out of this bush. This fire that represents renewal oftentimes in the Bible. So we said, we're running into the symbolic language again. 40, a long term of preparation. Fire, it is a renewal. A burning off of what's bad, a renewal to what's good. Okay? And out of the ground, God speaks to him. He's on holy ground, so he needs to respect that. It's made holy by God's presence. The space itself is not holy. It's not. There's nothing special about it except for the fact that God is speaking to him from this place. It's set apart because God meets us here in this place. Now, I will tell you, so in this reason, Moses takes his shoes off out of respect. So he's physically touching the ground. There's nothing now separating him from the space in which God occupies. Many of you watch me do music. For the most part, except obviously on Sunday mornings where it's impossible to do this, I take my shoes off when I play music. And I know people ask me, why do you do that? Because to me, music is a holy ground. It's where I interact with God. I touch God. God touches me in a spectacular way. In fact, Terry Bruce, one of the members of our church, often says, I play a lot better. He notices a difference of how I play when I have my shoes on and when I don't. There might be some truth to that. I feel really awkward when I have my shoes on. I feel like I'm disrespecting the presence of God, and I can't connect it in a very visceral way. But this is what Moses is doing. He takes his shoes off so he can connect directly with God. Now, also in this part of the lesson, God reintroduces himself to Moses. Now, you have to remember something. Moses grew up as an Egyptian. He knew he was a Jew, but he grew up with the Egyptian gods. So he doesn't know who this God is. God reintroduces Moses to the God of his ancestor, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the ones who ultimately came into to Egypt, and he is in that lineage, God tells him. Now, one of the things I want to point out to you that you may not be aware of, Jews at this point were not, okay, this is going to blow your mind, they were not monotheistic. You're like, sure that Abraham was monotheistic. Abraham was not a monotheist. He was a polytheistic person. He believed that there were many gods, but there was only one God that he believed worthy of being in service to. Okay? El Shaddai, the God of the mountains. He didn't know who this God was, not like Moses is now being introduced to him. That was the name of God prior to this. El Shaddai, God of the mountaintop, is the same name that all Canaanites used of God. El Shaddai, the God of the mountains, is a very generic name. So not even Abraham understood this God in the same way that now Moses is going to be introduced to this God just momentarily. So as I said, Abraham was not monotheistic. He had a monaltery, but not a monotheist, but a monalterist. And I'm like, wait a minute, I'm going to spell this for you. Okay, monaltery, M-O-N-A-L-A-T-R-Y, is a belief that there may be many gods, but there's only one which is worthy of my service. That was what Abraham believed. So monotheism is something that developed over time in the Jewish faith, where they realized, you know what, there aren't many gods, there's only one. And that's the one that we serve. So they're on a journey, just like we are. We haven't learned everything there is to know about God. They didn't learn everything there was to know about God. The fact there is one God worthy of being of serving was in of itself a revelation and blew their mind. So again, Abraham, not a monotheist. He was a monalterist. Monolaterist. Okay? Many gods, but he believed there's only one worthy of being of serving. So Moses didn't know this. He wasn't familiar with the God of Abraham. As I said, he grew up as an Egyptian with no experience with this God of Abraham. But what I find amazing about this, and I'm just pointing this out to you, that God, when God was going to do something spectacular in Egypt, he didn't go and find somebody who believed in the God of Abraham. He chose somebody who didn't even know who this God was. See, God often chooses non-believers, people that we least expect to do the most spectacular things. We Christians seem to think, oh, God is only going to serve this world through a good, godly Christian who grew up in our congregation. Well, that's bull. That's why I believe that God spoke through and often speaks through people who are not even Christians. Mahatma Gandhi. You're going to deny that God spoke through Mahatma Gandhi? God chose Mahatma Gandhi to speak to this world. God can choose anybody. God chose Moses. Why couldn't God choose Mahatma Gandhi? Mahatma Gandhi didn't believe in the God of our ancestors. Neither did Moses. But God chooses him. That's spectacular. I just love that. I go on. God hasn't forgotten his people. God has not forgotten you. God has not forgotten me. He promises then to deliver them. Then we get to this next part, the mission of Moses. Therefore, come now, God says. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, he says to Moses, so that you may bring my people to the sons of Israel out of Egypt. The sons of Israel out of Egypt. Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? See, this is typical Moses. He's always saying, God, come on, I think you're wrong. Okay? He doesn't believe in this God. He thinks this God is a crackpot right now. Are you kidding me? God said to him, certainly I will be with you. And this shall be the sign that you have, that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. How's that going to happen, God? Pharaoh's not going to let him go. Okay. Moses said, behold, I'm going. Then Moses said to God, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers sent me. Now, they may say to me, what's his name? See, he says, I don't even think the Jews know who the heck you are. They think I'm just an Egyptian. Who is it that sent me? What shall I say to them? God said, tell them I am who I am. He said, this is a different name of God. Prior to this, the Jews called God, as I mentioned to you, El Shaddai. Okay, God of the mountains. That was the primary name of God. This is a brand new name of God that has never been introduced until now. He said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent you. This is where we get the famous name of God we'll get to in just a minute. God furthermore said to Moses, thus shall you say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob has sent you. This is my name forevermore. And this is my memorial name to all generations. The name by which God will be known. We get introduced to the name of God for the first time, the unique name of God. This is the beginning of monotheism that we are going to learn. Now, as I said to you, the previous generations believed that there was one God worthy of being served. That was El Shaddai, the God of Abraham and Isaac. But now we are going to get a unique name of God, and we're starting to get this idea that maybe there is only one God. We'll come to this. This is what, there is a growing revelation in the Jewish nation. Moses' mission is objectors. Moses questions his own qualifications. He says, I'm not worthy of service, do you? But this is the entire point that God makes throughout the entire generations that God reaches to us. God chooses who we think are unqualified people to do the most spectacular things, to prove that it is God who does it. Because after all, we are just God's handiwork and we are God's tool. We are in service to God. And God does spectacular things through us. God promises to be with him. You see, it's, you know, a tool is just a tool. In the hands of a master, any tool, a saw can do spectacular things. In my hand, not so much, because I'm not a master woodworker. But in the hands of a master woodworker, the common, ordinary saw can do spectacular things. This is the point. God just chooses a common, ordinary saw, Moses. But it's in the hands of the master carpenter, who makes something spectacular out of it. Okay? So it's not the person, Moses. It's the person who wields the tool that does the spectacular thing. God promises then to be with him, even amidst the crisis that will take place when he goes to Pharaoh and presents this idea that God wants his people delivered. Now, this brings up the most spectacularly stupid phrase that we use as Christians. I'm telling you, don't use this to me, because everybody who uses this to me gets confronted. Okay, this is what people will say. Well, God never gives us more than we can handle. That is such bullcrap. You are not a follower of Jesus Christ. You're not getting anything on your palate. You obviously have not understand who God is if you believe that gibberish. God will never give me anything more than I can handle. Of course God gives you more than you can handle. You will often have a plate that's so full, you don't know what to do. But then guess what's going to happen? God will take care of it. You always have your life filled with more than you can handle. This world has more in its plate now than we can handle. Why? Because God is going to act and do something for us. God has not forgotten us in the midst of our pain and suffering. This world is chaos right now. We've got this COVID-19. We have our country. We're struggling with these racial divides and these political divides. We're ready to kill each other. But God is going to act. Okay? Rest in comfort with us. Where is more than you can handle right now? If you are overwhelmed, I get it. You know what? My summer, I'm telling you the truth. My summer is defined by how many ears of corn I get to eat and how many concerts I get to go to. The more concerts I get to go to, the more sweet corn I get to eat, the better the summer is. I've had 3 or 4 ears of corn this summer. That's it. I've gone to 0 concerts. It has been a crappy summer by any definition of the word, right? I'm ready to just, you know, I'm done with it. I'm ready to put my Christmas tree in and say, you know, the year's done. Okay? Let's hopefully get to a new year. You probably are too. It's been more than we can handle that's going on. But that gives room for God to act. So don't ever use that phrase, God won't give me more than I can handle. Well, tell that to the person whose child is dying of cancer. They've got more than they can handle. Okay? That's bull crap. But God intervenes and doesn't forget them. Moses again says, who are you? Who will I say sent me? God says, I am who I am. Now, this leads to a four-letter word that the Jews use for God. YHWH is what we transliterate that into English. That word, that name is never spoken. Its root is that to be verb. I am who I am. Prior to this, as I mentioned, they were calling God El Shaddai. But this name YHWH is so holy that they never pronounce it. Okay, never. They always, when they see that YHWH, they use the word Adonai, Lord. Just the generic name for God. Which is why when we Christians try to transliterate this or come up with the understanding of this, YHWH, we came up with this word, gibberish, by the way, Jehovah. That's a gibberish term. The Jehovah Witnesses call themselves Jehovah Witnesses. They don't realize they're using a gibberish word. Jehovah is meaningless. It's not a real word. Okay? We used to have that great song, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. Gibberish. It's not a real word, Jehovah. The Jews would never pronounce that, and I'm just asking and requesting of you. I know how it's pronounced. We actually know what the vowel points are now. However, it is a word out of respect to the Jews that we also should not pronounce. So I'm not going to pronounce it today. Adonai sent you. YHWH. So here's what we learned from our lesson today. God, I believe, is a God of relationship. God wants to be known by God's actions towards us. I am who I am. I'm going to be present with you. God does not forget us. We're living in a crummy time. We often have, and many people have, more than they can handle. We have a woman, we've got a woman in the congregation whose father-in-law just died of COVID-19. By the way, her father-in-law is about my age, okay? He died of COVID-19, was on a respirator for 2 weeks, died. Now their mother has it. Mother-in-law has it. What are you going to do? This family is more than they can handle right now. So don't be stupid. Don't go and say to that people, oh, God will never give you more than you can handle. Yeah, God will give you more than you can handle. But this is where God makes space to operate on our behalf. God has not forgotten us. When we are so overwhelmed that we don't know what to do and we can't handle it anymore, God intervenes on our behalf. And God wants to be a part of our lives. And God chooses to do spectacular things through just ordinary tools and vessels like you and me. Oh, isn't this a cool lesson? God has not forgotten you. God promises to use you and have a relationship with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even in a world where we have more than we can handle, you've not forgotten us. We give you thanks that you are present with us today to heal us, to make us whole. We know that you're acting in this world right now. And just entrust our lives to you and to your care this day and pray that you'd use us to be messengers of this good news to this world. For we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. May God make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you in favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.